Hey everybody, TJ here from I Need More Space. I typically don't do these like news videos, but I felt like this was something that we should really talk about. This week, NASA and Boeing completed their test review from the botched Boeing Starliner launch a few months ago, back in December 2019. Something that we all kind of knew was that Boeing was always kind of the favorite child in the commercial crew program between Boeing and SpaceX, where Boeing got more funding and frankly, just some more leeway in their program. SpaceX was just looked at under a microscope, but we never really had anything official until now. NASA essentially admits that they gave Boeing a very long leash during this process and trusted them because of their history with the space shuttle and the International Space Station and other cost-plus contracts that they've worked on, Space Launch System included. Now, I can go into this in a lot of detail, but I figured I'd let the NASA spokespeople just talk for themselves. This was initially a one-hour-long phone call that I decided to cut down to the most important aspects. The two NASA spokespeople that you're here today is Kathy Luters, who is the Associate Administrator of Human Exploration and Operations Mission Directorate. Congratulations on your promotion. And Steve Stitch, the Commercial Crew Program Manager. So they're the folks that really oversaw this review and are falling on the sword, so to speak. So let's just have a listen.
It's great to be here today to continue to talk about our progress as we work toward the OFT-2 mission with our Boeing provider. When we talked last to you in the March timeframe, at the time they had come up with 61 recommendations, which we were in the process of reviewing. But since that time, those really dealt with the two primary anomalies on the flight, the liftoff time anomaly with the Starliner grabbing that time from the Atlas vehicle, and also the separation associated with the independent propulsion controller at the end of the flight. Since then, we've implemented a number of other recommendations dealing with the communications anomalies, and now we're up to a total of 80 recommendations that you'll see on the blog post. We had the team interviewed about a total of 20 plus people across NASA and Boeing to try to better understand other causes that could have led to the anomalies that we saw on the OFT mission back in December. So that report is closed out. Some of the things that we looked at was, did we have the right level of engagement from the beginning? And I'll remind people that the commercial model that we're utilizing has shared accountability between NASA and the contractor. When we went back and looked at our culture and the way we were approaching software development with Boeing, perhaps we didn't have as many people as embedded in that process as we should have.
Whenever you go through one of these things, it's a real huge learning opportunity for us then to look at our other processes with a new lens and just make sure that we're able to not only find the initial error, but also that we have ways through our testing and assessment programs to be able to catch the errors at the right time. Boeing also is changing how they're doing business too, right? I think this is a place where both Boeing and NASA were learning together about doing business in this new way. This was a different model than having a cost-plus contract with Boeing. And I think that's going to be real learning that we can take forward into our human lander system program.
We tend to try to ask ourselves all the time when we're working with both partners, are we looking at the higher risk systems on each vehicle consistently? Across the board for each mission, I think we've done a really good job of looking at all the higher risk areas and trying to focus on things that would be really detrimental if they happen in the flight. I would say in the software area, from a NASA perspective, we may have been focused a little more on SpaceX because they use a bit of a non-traditional approach to their software development in terms of maybe a bit of a spiral development, and then they code to the requirements and they do unit tests and they do all the kinds of typical software testing, but they maybe do it in a kind of a spiral development approach, which many aerospace companies do these days. And so we may have had a few more people looking at that. And then we were, I would say, a little more used to the Boeing process. It's one that we have used in the past in successful NASA programs like Space Shuttle and the International Space Station, where you lay out all the requirements for the software and then you hand them to the software team, and then they implement those requirements, they test them at kind of a module level, and then as they integrate modules, they test them. And so perhaps we were a little more focused on SpaceX. I think now looked back across both companies and tried to balance the portfolio of people we have. We've certainly added resources to both software development on SpaceX and Boeing. These are complicated spacecraft with launching, landing, and then they do ascent aborts, and they do aborts as well close to the space station. So we've augmented resources on both partners to make sure that we're covered. When one provider has a newer approach than another, it's often natural for a human being to spend more time on that newer approach, and maybe we didn't quite take the time we needed with the more traditional approach. We had maybe more familiarity with the Boeing process from those that had worked on International Space Station. Many of the team that did the software for International Space Station was actually working on the Starliner, and so we just didn't quite take the time that we needed to. In hindsight, these high visibility close calls and these investigations, you know, many times I've seen it over my career, it's a little more obvious afterwards than when you're in the middle of it, and I think we've sort of learned that lesson, and we're applying it equally across both providers. We're looking across multiple systems on the vehicles, whether it be the launch vehicle, the launch pad, the control centers, to see if we have any other gaps. I think one of the things that these close calls do for you, and Kathy talked about that for human lander systems, it's a bit of a wake-up call for NASA and its contractors. And I would tell you all the contractors were interested when the anomalies happen, when we had the IRT, they all want the lessons learned because they all know that this business is really tough.
This has been a big learning experience for us. I tell people, and people get tired of hearing that, and that this was a gift, but this is helping us develop more robust thought processes across the mission directorate and then be able to provide that learning to the joint contractor NASA team for us to continue to apply these lessons to our further and future success on the tough missions we have going forward.
When SpaceX had heard of the anomaly, even during the OFT mission, they began to contact us and ask questions about what, if anything, they could do to prevent this from happening on any of their flights. And I think in the aerospace industry, all of the companies are sort of in it together, and they all understand how tough it is. And so all the companies, Sierra Nevada, Axiom, and others, are interested in learning from this particular anomaly.
So that's really it. I could give NASA a lot of credit. It took a lot of guts for them to come out to the public and say, we tried our best, but it wasn't enough. And I really hope that they learn from this. I think it's only going to make the commercial crew program better. I'd love to hear what you all have to think in the comments below about this. And let's just hope for a brighter future with the commercial crew program, and that Boeing can just move on and have a great OFT too. All right. Thanks for watching. Hope you learned something. Bye.